much, Chris. All right, how are we all doing this afternoon? Okay, that's not as much energy as I expected, but that's all right. So thank you, Chris, for the introduction. My name is Lindsay Holmwood. I am an engineering manager over at Envato. So we're going to talk today a little bit about things that are sort of outside the technology space. So things that technical leaders and people who want to level up in their career over the next sort of 5 to 10 years should start looking at and thinking about. So my journey in the DevOps space started almost 10 years ago to this date. I was at a bit of a crossroads in my career, in that I, until that point, had been flip-flopping between being a software engineer and working as a systems administrator. And it got to this point where it was actually like negatively impacting my ability to be able to get a new job, because recruiters would look at my resume and go, oh, like, you've done a whole bunch of work, and you keep flip-flopping between being like a developer and a sysadmin. You have to choose. You have to choose one, and you have to stick with it. And you know, that was always a very interesting thing to hear, sort of circa 10 years ago. And you know, there was a lot of conventional wisdom to it. But the thing that sort of really got me into the DevOps space was that I had sort of just seen the light with behavior-driven development using a little known sort of tool at the time called Cucumber. Quick show of hands, who here has used Cucumber? And okay, so like most of the room, that's fantastic. So the thing that Cucumber really revealed to me was that there was a huge amount of overlap between the sort of outside-in tests that we do in software development and the sort of monitoring that we actually want to do of these systems that are running in production. So I sort of had this idea of, you know, what if we could use the same tools that we're using for software engineering for, you know, testing our infrastructure, and we could actually not just run those tests sort of as we make changes, but actually all the time. And we could, we could hook that up to our monitoring. And so a little known sort of tool at the time that I spawned was a thing called Cucumber Nagios. Quick show of hands, who here has used that? Maybe way back in the day? Yeah, basically nobody. Cool, not unexpected. So because I had released that tool and I was sort of like one of the few people in that space that was writing tools like that, I got invited to this little known event at the time called DevOps Days. In Belgium. It was just a sort of a small intimate meeting of about sort of, you know, 50, 70 people all up. John was there, which was awesome. And as they say, the rest is history. Here I am. So that was 10 years ago now. And, you know, 10 years is a pretty big delta in the technology industry, as we're all very much aware. And so what I want to think about with DevOps and what were the conditions 10 years ago, I want to look at it sort of through the lens of complexity and complexity science. So in complexity science, there is this thing known as sensitive dependence on initial conditions. Can anybody take a guess what the more colloquial term for that is? The butterfly effect, very good. When it comes to sort of understanding how we have ended up here, it's really important to understand what were the initial conditions that were leading the sort of group of practitioners to get together and talk about, you know, solving the problem of software engineering and software delivery and software operations on a day-to-day basis and how we could make that better. So one of the things that I think gets completely overlooked when we talk about the DevOps movement is that we were doing all of this in the era of post-GFC scarcity. So there was not a lot of money to go around because of the, you know, financial markets crashing all around the world. And so that meant that more and more organizations were requiring an increased operational tempo on a day-to-day basis to be able to get stuff done. And of course, you know, there was less money to be able to go around, right? So that sort of was a pretty sort of complex set of challenges there. We're also finding that because there were these sort of increased demands around this increased operational tempo, the siloization was becoming a less viable organizational strategy. So, you know, the typical way that we would do delivery in sort of that waterfall model of, you know, your people that sort of define the problem and then people that, like, write the code that solves the problem, hopefully, and then, like, a long lead time before it's actually running in prod, like, this is not a viable strategy anymore because of that increased operational tempo. The other thing that was happening from a technology perspective was that the infrastructure that we were running our stuff on was becoming a lot more commoditized and on demand. You know, you think back to 2009, where DevOps was sort of originating. You know, a lot of people were interested in doing stuff on top of AWS, and it sort of made a lot of sense, particularly in this post-GFC world of scarcity, that we, you know, would want to only pay for the thing while we are using it. You know, we don't want to do big capital investments up front and, you know, sort of manage all these servers and sort of manage the fleet and, you know, the asset depreciation and all that boring financial stuff. And the other thing that was sort of interesting here as well is that the barrier of entry for development tools had been lowered quite significantly. If you look at sort of the software engineering practice around that time, because things like you know, behavior-driven development were sort of becoming a little bit more popular, the quality of the tools has sort of gotten to the point where it was easier and easier for people to be able to get in the industry. There were more people from a sort of traditional systems administration and operations background that were able to take existing open source infrastructure and be able to use that to solve problems in a completely different domain than what those tools had originally been built. And so, you know, you look at this and how this all adds up together, and we end up with this confluence of factors that really, you know, drives the movement in a very particular direction, which is, you know, where we are today. And I don't think, you know, in the same way that when we're looking at a murmuration here, it's really impossible to predict that we would have ended up here 10 years ago. But, you know, nonetheless, we are here today. All right. So if we look at the last 10 years really quickly through three different lenses of delivery, systems, and people, and we're going to start with delivery here. So delivery, the operating models, you know, before were sort of traditionally waterfall. People were trying to do agile in sort of the infrastructure and operations space, but there wasn't really a big body of knowledge of it. And, you know, post then, if we look at now, you know, agile and lean ways of sort of structuring ourselves and the way that we work on a day-to-day basis is pretty much the standard way that we do stuff inside our industry now. Fun fact, it's if you go back and you look on Google Groups and you search for a group called Agile Systems Administration, that's really where the first seeds of DevOps were planted. There was a little bit of a conversation there between Patrick Dubois, who sort of kicked off the initial DevOps days, and a bunch of other folks from around the world. And, you know, that's really the genesis of all this. It's, you know, how do we take this sort of complex field of systems administration and meld it with this new way of working agile? And, you know, that's how we sort of have DevOps today. Another thing that's different on the delivery side is the deployment frequency. So, you know, we think, you know, before we were doing like weekly or maybe monthly deploys, and probably monthly realistically. And if we look at it now, you know, most of us are operating in an environment where we're doing at least one deploy a day, if not multiple deploys a day. And you look at the really high performers like Amazon who are, you know, rolling out changes, like, you know, a new change that's being deployed at least like once every 2.5 seconds, which is just sort of phenomenal when you think about it. And, you know, if we were to go back in time and we were to tell ourselves, you know, 10 years ago that you'd have big global infrastructure companies like Amazons and your Googles and your Facebooks rolling out changes with that level of frequency, it would just be unfathomable. So the delta is very, very large there. And so continuous delivery is essentially the standard, at least within the web industry. As soon as you start going outside of that, then the story gets very, very different, particularly with sort of other organizations that are not thinking of themselves as software companies or technology companies anymore. So the next lens is systems, and if we look at that on the infrastructure side of things, before it was sort of a blend of bare metal and virtualized. There would be some sort of on-prem or maybe some sort of hosting provider, whatever that means. And these days, you'd be lucky to find any sort of organization that hasn't moved the majority of their workloads, at least in the web industry, over to infrastructure as services or platforms as a service. And there's this real commodification of infrastructure here as well, the sort of rising tide of commodification over the last 10 years. On the infrastructure management, of course, you know, because we're now moving everything into the cloud. Before, you know, the way that we would do this would be scripting, or maybe some people on the cutting edge would be doing things with config management tools like Puppet and Chef. And now, you know, we have very, very powerful config management. And, you know, it exists at a couple of different levels as well, not just on, like, the individual compute node, but also config management for managing the entire infrastructure. On the architecture side of things, You know, before the sort of predominant architecture model was monoliths, I guess everybody says that we're doing microservices now. I don't know if that's actually true. Like a fundamental question here of, is this reality or is this aspirational? I'll give you the answer of I don't actually know. That will be interesting to see over the next couple of years. Another thing that's changed there is the deployment unit, or the unit of deployment has gone from virtual machines now to containers. And you know, it's questionable whether we're going to go down the functions path, but that's going to sort of be interesting to see. Lastly, on the people lens, how we respond to failure. Back in the day, we had a very much a blame culture, where you know we would find the bad apples in our midst, and we try and pin responsibility for bad actions that happen on those people in those complex systems. And you know, particularly with people like John Allspaw within the movement, we've seen this real rise of just culture within the DevOps space, and sort of a focus on the human impact of that, and understanding how humans fit as actors in complex systems. And you know, blameless postmortems are probably the most obvious artifact of that cultural transformation that's happened within the technology industry. And you know, a lot of people do this on a day-to-day, a lot of people are trying to do this, but you know, it's still you still see examples of, like even in the news today, with that sort of leak about Facebook having about sort of 600 million username and password combinations stored in plain text since 2011. At the very, very bottom of the couple of the news articles, they're all saying it was a rogue development team. So clearly that blameless postmortem culture has not permeated into, say, legal teams. We have relationships to our coworkers as well as radically changed because of those sort of increased demands for operational tempo. So before we were focused on silos, and now we're really focusing on empathy. And you know, either by getting people co-located in the same team and aligned together to solve the same problems, or sort of doing like paste layering on top of one another. So you know, we've really built this DevOps culture through these shared experiences of developers being on call and the ops folk that are writing the code. And the real sort of fundamental transformation here, I think, within the web industry that's worth noting is that we've organized ourselves around the deployment pipeline, right? That is the way that that all changes that we make inside of our organizations are made, right? There are strong cultural norms that are in place and, you know, in some cases, penalties that apply if you're making changes in the wild that aren't going through deployment pipelines. So, with that in mind, where we are at the moment, what's next? And I think Niels Bohr said it best, which is the prediction is very difficult, especially about the future. So I'm not going to try and make any predictions about the future here, you know, because I have enough difficulty predicting what's going to happen next week, let alone 5 or 10 years from now. Although that said, I do have an interesting track record of, you know, back in November 2010, I wrote this piece about is DevOps being hijacked by technologists. Turns out that that was way more prescient than what I necessarily expected at the time. So, if we were talking about the conditions, the initial conditions, because we have this sensitive dependence on these initial conditions for you know, 10 years ago and how DevOps sort of came to be and sprung forth, you know, what are some of the conditions now? Because those are the things that are very obvious and plain to see that are, you know, in front of us on a day-to-day basis. So one thing that we do know is that the DevOps dream is here, but it ain't evenly distributed. So if you look at the Accelerate State of DevOps report, there's this really fantastic chart in it fairly early on that says that, you know, we've got these, we basically group these organizations that have submitted information into these sort of 4 different categories. You've got elite, high performer, medium performers, or low performers. And the commentary around this particular graph is that overall, the industry is improving its software development and delivery practices. And so, in fact, that cohort of high performers is increasing in size over time, so much so that for the last State of DevOps report in 2018, they actually split it out into this elite unit all the way up the top here. So that's a pretty good news story for the industry as a whole. But the low performers are struggling to keep up. You know, the gap, in fact, is widening between the high performers and the low performers, let alone the elite performers and the low performers. So as Gibson said, the future is here. It's very clearly not evenly distributed. Other interesting sort of conditions that are changing around us that we may not necessarily be paying so much attention to is we're seeing increasing and fragmented regulation, which we as technologists are forced to sort of resolve at the coalface, which is really, really interesting. So, you know, the obvious example of that is the GDPR. In Australia, we've got the notifiable data breach system that's instituted by OAIC. We've got the Australian privacy principles as well. Interesting problems there around like incongruent legislation where, you know, for a while the Australian privacy principles were regarded as essentially as a gold standard around the world. Now GDPR has sort of leapfrogged them, but, you know, there are incongruent things between those two different bits of legislation. So for companies that are operating on the global scale, this poses some really, really difficult, both legal problems, but also technical problems. And then we see things like the Netflix tax as well, where we want to have, you know, GST applied to overseas, transactions made with overseas companies. And, you know, those are the local sort of parochial Australian examples of them. You know, if you go over to the US, for instance, you know, we're seeing like taxation that is being collected down to like the county level. So you can have incongruent taxation schemes, you know, within you know, streets of one another, which is just sort of mind-boggling. But at least on the privacy front, we can say that this is good for society, but really it is a pain in the ass for us as technologists. And, you know, that's the world that we live in, and we're going to do our best. One interesting way that a couple of people have started to try and attack this problem is this institution called AI Now. They published this piece back in nearly a year ago called The Algorithmic Impact Assessments, a Practical Framework for Public Agency Accountability. And so this is a really interesting way of getting on the front foot about actually understanding how, say, machine learning and artificial intelligence gets applied to human populations. And it's really important that we actually have people working on the front lines of this so that we actually get to have a say in what policymakers are going to make decisions and laws about that are going to affect us even more on a day-to-day basis. So, you know, frameworks for accountability, super, super important. Other things, custom ASICs are proliferating. So we've seen like in the last sort of 12, 18 months that Cloudflare, for instance, is doing a slow transition over to ARM on all of their edge nodes, which is really, really interesting. And, you know, if you look at the performance side of that, it's about like for like in most cases with ARM versus Intel. The interesting benefit that they get is that their power bills are significantly reduced. They normally have somewhere between 40 and 60% reduction in their power spend, which, you know, when you are operating a global company with locations in multiple POPs, then, you know, a 40 to 60% reduction in power spend is actually really, really important. We see, you know, highly customized ASICs, like, you know, for ASICs for Bitcoin mining. So this is an Ant miner here. So, you know, just putting the ethics of Bitcoin aside for a second and the impact on the environment. Actually, you know, I'll go into that for a second. So one interesting thing to note is that there are some reports that have come out in the last couple of weeks that say that the impact of Bitcoin mining on our energy consumption at the moment is actually negating any benefit that we're getting out of renewables globally. That is fucking crazy. All right, so I'm just going to park that and we'll come back to that. The last here is the tensor processing unit. So, you know, this is a very custom ASIC that's built by Google here. This is something that this is not something that you can go and buy off the shelf. You know, these are provided on proprietary cloud platforms like Google Cloud. And that's sort of really, really interesting. And it plays into this next point, which is around machine learning is becoming a hell of a lot more accessible. So this bit of hardware here that we see, the tensor processing unit, this is version 3 of it. I think they've got a version 4 that they deployed you know, about a couple of months ago. That was really the backbone of this Google neural machine translation body of research that's emerged from the Google Brain folk. And this is, you know, this is completely transforming the way that things like Google Translate and the accuracy and the fluency of translations, you know, to the point that it's like a step function jump, like people who don't know that the implementation of the system but are using Google Translate on a day-to-day were noticing that there was significant quality improvements just through a one-to-one substitution of the previous statistical models that we were using for translating between languages and the new neural network-based translation. I mean, the really fascinating thing about this is that the way that the machine learning basically adapted, just to simplify this massively, to be able to provide better translations was that the algorithms were incrementally evolved to a point where, rather than trying to do a one-for-one translation between one language and another, the system ended up building an intermediary language that sits in between the two. And so this wasn't something that was constructed by humans. This is a way that the machine learning actually evolved through thousands of iterations, hundreds, millions of thousands of iterations. And that is crazy. Like, that is like biological design being applied in software, software development, software engineering. And then, like, we see like really fun things like this with like generative adversarial networks. This is a demo released by NVIDIA just a couple of days ago, where you can draw these really, really simple pictures here, and sort of select the sort of scenery that you're looking for, and it will go and it will generate a photorealistic landscape. So that's all pretty wild. So, rather than trying to predict the future, we've talked about some of the initial conditions, let's talk about some of the skills for managing uncertainty and ambiguity over the next sort of 5 to 10 years. And really what I'm talking about here is mental models for understanding culture, which is the really hard part of DevOps, harnessing mirroring, mapping strategy, and managing risk. And all these things relate to one another. Right, so let's start with the real basics, the fundamental building blocks of understanding culture. So I want to say up front that within technology, we don't know shit about culture. There are so many talks that you see on the conference circuit talking about culture in these completely abstract terms. There is a whole body of academic research and literature in sociology that tells us, and anthropology, that tells us all sorts of things about culture. Perhaps we should pay a little bit more attention to that. So Edgar Schein is sort of his model is fairly definitive. It's used really heavily in anthropological circles. So his model is that there are three different levels of culture. And so in those three different levels of culture, at the topmost we've got artifacts, next layer down we've got values, the last we've got assumptions. And that culture can exist at a national, organizational, team, or occupational level. So if we talk about artifacts, now artifacts are the physical manifestations of our culture. They're things like the ceremonies that we run on a day-to-day basis, the org charts and the way that we imagine that people are organized within our organizations, the desk layouts, whether you're sort of toiling away in a cube farm or like a tremendously noisy open plan office, documentation that we write to prescribe particular processes or explain how things are done. Also, the software that we write as part of our organizations is also an artifact of our culture. So all of these artifacts are the most visible parts of an organization's culture. They're also the easiest part of a culture to be able to adopt. And that, I posit, is why DevOps over the last 10 years has been so focused on the tools, right? Because it's a hell of a lot easier to pick up the latest and greatest tool than it is to actually affect any sort of realistic and tangible culture change within an organization. So, as sad as I am that perhaps the culture piece has been lost a little bit in the last couple of years, there's a very good anthropological explanation for why we focus more on the tools than on the culture. So then the next layer down is the values. And so the values are the conscious goals, strategies, and philosophies that we have within our organizations. They are the rules that guide how we interact with people in our organizations, and also the rules that guide how we do our work. So things like, we are going to dominate the market. Management is available and listens to our concerns. We value quality over delivery speed. Nobody will be fired for making an honest mistake. And the thing that's really important to note here is that there is a difference between lived values and aspirational values. So it's an important thing to think about when you're hearing about other people's DevOps journeys and their organizations. How much of it is actually lived versus how much of it is actually aspirational. So, you know, examples of, like other examples of values that we might see are communication. We have an obligation to communicate. Respect, we treat each other as we like to be treated. Integrity, we work with customers and prospects openly, honestly, and sincerely. Excellence, we're satisfied with nothing less than the very best in everything that we do. Ethical, we conduct business affairs in accordance with all applicable laws in a moral and honest manner. Now, fun fact, these were all the stated values of... So, as you can see, there is a little bit of a gap between how we imagine work is done in our organizations versus how it is actually done on a day-to-day basis. So it's really important for leaders to be clear about what values are what. Are they actually our lived values, or are they our aspirational values? The last layer down is assumptions. So the last layer is about the beliefs, perceptions, thoughts, and feelings that exist at an unconscious level. These are very hard to discern. They can be things like anybody can take on a leadership responsibility, bad outcomes come from bad people, it's okay to withhold information, individual performance is valued over team performance, we can trust that team, or maybe we can't trust that team. And the real challenge with assumptions is that you don't tend to sort of notice what they are until you've been in a position for sort of like 18, 24 months. And often they can leave people sort of feeling a little bit like this. Okay, so we've got Edgar Schein's model here for artifacts, values, and assumptions, right? So we know that our systems are artifacts, our processes are artifacts. We also know that the design of artifacts influences our values, and the design of our values influences our assumptions. And it's a symbiotic relationship at all different levels, right? So the tools are a snapshot of our organization's culture. They're a snapshot of the org's values and assumptions. We know that artifacts influence this behavior. And so we can do a lot, particularly when you're trying to perform some sort of cultural transformation within an organization, to encode the behavior that you want to see in your organization into the artifacts, right? So you change your org's values by changing your artifacts. So examples of that are things like all of your changes have to go through a CD pipeline, or we create fast feedback loops to learn from changes in production. Developers and managers, that's reinforcing this value of creating fast feedback loops, right? Artifacts, things like developers and managers all participate in the on-call schedule. And that's reinforcing this value of performance, availability, and sustainability are everybody in the organization's responsibility. Artifacts like our ceremonies include and engage non-technical disciplines. The value is that nobody has all the answers, but we're going to succeed by working together, which is really, really important. That's what DevOps is fundamentally all about. But the tools fundamentally are just a means to an end, right? The goal is actually transforming our ways of working, right? So if you're interested in any of this and sort of leveling up and having this anthropological perspective, I would really recommend that you check out this book by Edgar Schein, Organizational Culture and Leadership. It is your foundational text within that field. So the next thing that we want to talk about for skills is harnessing mirroring. So who here knows who this is?
Conway,
very good. Somebody very scholarly. Okay, so Melvin Conway had this great adage that he published in the early 70s, saying that organizations which design systems are constrained to produce designs which are copies of the communication structures of these organizations, right? So we call it Conway's law. It's not technically a law, it's more like an adage or an anthropological observation. But it's interesting because it originated at a really similar time to a whole bunch of other research in completely separate fields on this particular topic. So the way that this is actually talked about in organizational science and management science is this concept called mirroring. So we had this foundational paper that was posted or published in late 2016, called the Mirroring Hypothesis, Theory, Evidence, and Exceptions. And the hypothesis is stated very succinctly: in a complex system, the technical architecture and the division of labor will mirror one another in the sense that the network structure of one will correspond to the structure of the other. So let's break that down a little bit. And to do that, we have to look at two separate research traditions that are studying that mirroring. So one is in computer science with Conway's law, which, to be honest, there's been sporadic research over the last sort of four decades. It really picked up in the open source world, sort of from about the late 90s onwards. The other research tradition is in management, so org and product design, and talking about and understanding organizations and products as complex systems. So what is mirroring if we break this down? So fundamentally it's this. Within any organization, there are two networks. One that is organizational, so how we say that we organize ourselves, our ways of working as people. And the other one is the technical, so the way that the systems themselves within our complex systems relate to one another. Right. So the way you can think about it is, like, to treat it really simply, it's like a directed acyclical graph, right? So you've got this, you've got one network that is organizational and another one is technical. And so when we overlay the two on top of one another, we say that we are mirroring, right? And the reason that we do this is that it's a very effective way of solving problems. It also takes people to where the problems are. It also helps us solve this really, really simple question, which is, who owns these systems, right? We can say that there's a one-to-one mapping between, say, a team name and a system name, or a team name and a product name. We also do this from a purely capitalist perspective, that it's super, super economical. So a great example of this is in this paper by Galbraith in 1974 called Organization Design and Information Processing View. So to give you the highlights of this paper, it's a little bit long, Galbraith posits that as uncertainty increases, the amount of information that must be processed by decision makers also increases. The org can respond by reducing the need to process information or by increasing the capacity to process that information. So it's got two different ways of being able to do that. One is through the creation of Slack resources and the creation of self-contained tasks. So it's sort of like that organizational principle that you see in some of the bigger players where you have two pizza teams, or if you can't feed the team with two pizzas, then you need to start splitting things up. And it's really important. The thing that often gets missed is that it's not just splitting the team up, it's also taking an axe to the system so that the systems follow and very strongly mirror the new organizational design. So if you do that, then it becomes easier to create self-contained tasks and units of work. The other way that you can do this is through the investment in vertical information systems, so making it easier for information to traverse up and down the hierarchy of an organization, and the creation of lateral relations within an organization. And all of those are guided by rules, programs, hierarchical referral, and goal settings. So the thing that's really important in this model is that this is exactly, this point number seven here, this seventh strategy, is exactly what DevOps is. It's about creating lateral relations within an organization to be able to more effectively process information and deal with uncertainty. That's all that it is. And so to create lateral relations, we can do that through direct contact, liaison roles, task force teams, all these different ways of doing things, right? And so like the traditional way that we talk about it in like a manufacturing sense is that you've got a GM and you've got product management, engineering, manufacturing, and marketing. And there's a bunch of people that are sort of more specialized and subject matter experts. And so all those people within the various sub-products are pulled together underneath that particular product line. So that's the traditional way that we deal with this in manufacturing, right? Within an ops, a DevOps context, it's actually not too dissimilar. We can sort of change a couple of those different labels there. So we've got DevOps and design and, you know, different specialties within that. Hopefully if you do that, everything is going to be great, right? So why do we stop at devs and ops, right? Like, obviously we want to, include more people as part of this. That was the original dream of DevOps. We can also include things like support, marketing, design, analytics, legal, finance. But I think the really interesting question is, what happens if we don't do that? So, another really interesting paper from 1990 by Henderson and Clark called Architectural Innovation, the Reconfiguration of Existing Product Technologies and the Failure of Established Firms. So, this is a three-year study of the semiconductor photolithographic alignment equipment industry. So this is a field-based study in a high rate of change industry. So by high rate of change, it's this longitudinal study looking at four different ways of innovation within this industry between 1962 and 1986. And so with each successive wave of technical innovation, so finding new technical methods to be able to solve this problem, there was major changes in who was dominant in that industry. So after every wave of innovation, there was a new leader every single time, without fail, right? So every incumbent was unable to course correct, even though every incumbent invested really heavily in new technology, trying to actually adapt to the new way of building things, and different sort of technologies structured differently, right? So the reason behind that is that each incumbent structured their organization and communication based on their existing product architecture, right? So they didn't disrupt the organization of people to match the new technologies that were at play. So what makes sense about this? Well, so Henderson and Clark have this framework for defining innovation. And what they say is that in any organization, when the organization is first being established, it's typically engaging in some sort of radical innovation, which then moves to modular innovation. And organizations sort of cycle between modular innovation and incremental innovation. And when they're doing that, they are sort of switching between reinforcing and overturning core concepts, but are not changing the linkages between concepts and components. Pretty simple. But what's required to be able to take advantage of new technologies is that you actually have to engage in this architectural innovation. Right. But none of these organizations, when they were engaging in this architectural innovation, did anything to change the structure of how they manage people. Right. So, the TLDR here is that this is a strongly mirrored system, and this is a weakly mirrored system. So we can say here that when you are engaging in modular and incremental innovation, you want a mirror, and when you're engaging in architectural innovation and radical innovation, you don't want a mirror, right? So how do you know as your organization whether you are engaging in these different types of, should you be mirroring or not mirroring? What sort of innovation are you engaging in, right? So this is where mapping comes in, and mapping becomes super, super important. So we often use the word strategy as a substitute for the word plan, right? Strategy is not just having a plan, it's understanding how you react in complex environments and what your criteria are for making decisions when you face uncertainty. Mike Tyson said it best, everybody has a plan until they get punched in the mouth. So, let's do a mapping 101 exercise. So why do we map? The whole purpose of mapping is to build collective context, which informs strategic technology decisions and understand and visualize trade-offs. Sidney Decker said it best, we need multiple overlapping and partially contradictory descriptions of the same act, and in fact, they are even necessary to approximate the complexity of reality. So the thing about mapping exercises is that they are super subjective because we're doing them to navigate complexity, discover ambiguities, and discover uncertainties in our environments, right? To be really clear, maps don't replace architectural diagrams. So architectural diagrams and maps are sort of complementary tools. They're just operating at different levels of abstraction, right? So we're going to use this tool called Wardley mapping. So a Wardley map is a tool that clarifies relationships between different systems in a complex environment, positions in the value chain, and the evolution and maturity of those systems. So it's a tool that helps us clarify hotspots and where new initiatives that we want to do are fitting, right? So the way that it works is that down the y-axis, we have the visibility of customer all the way from it's super visible to it's practically invisible. And along the x-axis, we've got the evolution or maturity of a technology or a system. So all the way from it's brand new, untested, through to it's custom built but working relatively well and we're getting some sort of commercial return on it, through to product, through to commodity. So like commodities like power, electricity, power, water. The cloud is probably a good example of a commodity at this point. So the way that this works is that you start with the user needs at the outermost edge, then we add the most visible systems, and these solid lines represent these dependencies between them, and we just keep adding dependent systems, and it works something a little bit like this. Okay, so let me give you a practical example of this. About 18 months ago, I was engaged by SBS to work on their on-demand product. And so I was basically given a remit of going into SBS. I had 5 days to understand what was happening with on-demand, how the people and systems were interacting with one another, and then make a bunch of recommendations to the C-suite about what we could do to make it better so that they wouldn't go down during the World Cup. And so we did a group Wardley mapping exercise that ended up looking something a little bit like this. And so when we cleaned it up a little bit, it looked a little bit more like this, right? anyway. And so the thing that's really important when you do these sort of Wardley mapping exercises is that it helps you identify two things, right? The things that are part of the iceberg that is above the water. So these things all the way up here, so things like the mobile apps, websites, connected TV, Apple TV, and how all these things relate to one another. Plus, we can look below the waterline. So these are all of the other systems behind the scenes that are required to make any of this work. And the interesting thing that we were able to learn through this mapping exercise is that on the maturity scale through from Genesis through to commodity, they actually were doing really, really well. They had made the right technology choices at the right levels within that map, right? There wasn't anything obvious that you go, why are you building your own CI/CD tools from scratch, right? But what it did help us identify was that there was a lot of tool duplication. So we were able to actually start aggregating tools together and be able to reduce costs and reduce risk and reduce complexity. So one of the other things that we can do is use these markers to represent the direction of travel and to be able to visualize opportunities. So something to keep in mind is that all of this is subjective. Visibility informs priority. Maturity informs the investment. They don't ever replace arch diagrams, but they do, and these maps do actually change over time. I think David Woods had a really good observation about complex systems, which is that his theorem is that as the complexity of a system increases, the accuracy of a single agent's own model of these systems decreases rapidly, which is why it's really, really important when you're doing these Wardley mapping exercises to do it in a group context. So if you want to learn a little bit more about Wardley maps, go check out the Wardley maps book online. It is huge. There's like, I think, 18 chapters, and they're all about a 30 to 50 minute read on Medium. It's all free. Thank you, Simon Wardley. If you've got a little bit less time than that, go check out Wardley Mapping for Busy People. So you can see here, I'll post the URLs at the end so you can go and take a photo later. Other things in the complexity space, I highly recommend having a watch of this series of short courses from the great courses called Understanding Complexity. It covers all these topics here that you can see on the side, particularly the explore-exploit dichotomy, which I touched on before when we were talking about architectural innovation. The other thing that's worth checking if you're interested in learning more about this is the thing called the Stellar Report, a whole bunch of really interesting applications of complexity science in a technical domain. So the last piece that we're going to talk about very quickly is managing risk. So who here is this their way of like managing and quantifying risk within their organizations right now? Okay, so everybody who doesn't have their hand up is a fucking liar right now. This is the typical way that we do things, right, within business. And so we see, you know, this probability impact matrix. It gets translated to risk registers, some of which have, you know, thousands, if not tens of thousands of items on them. And, you know, it's a completely unrealistic way, and it doesn't give us any sort of tools or any sort of handhold to be able to hold on to when we're scaling the mountain that is risk. So highly recommend checking out this from Douglas Hubbard. Quick show of hands, who here has seen or read either of these books? Okay, great. So for everybody who didn't have your hand up, if you want to provide more value to your organization, go and read How to Measure Anything in Cybersecurity Risk. So Hubbard's model is really simple. So we have the likelihood. We want to quantify risk by saying that the likelihood is the percentage chance that the bad thing is going to happen within the next 12 months. And the impact is the dollar cost to the organization of the impact expressed as a range, so a lower and upper bounds, right? So what that means is that we have the before of, it looks something a little bit like this, and we transform it to be something a bit like this. So there's a 40% likelihood of an impact range between $4 million and $8 million, right? Very, very simple. So this is a framework that you can use, and it works very, very well. It's quite complementary to maps for when you're actually understanding your risk landscape. So the steps are really simple. Understand and aggregate the risk proposition, your overall risk position. You compare to your appetite of your organization. And then we invest in, and we can start making decisions about where we invest in reducing uncertainty and mitigation overall, right? So with all that said, the biggest risk for everybody here in this room who considers themselves to be part of the DevOps movement or a DevOps engineer or whatever label you want to apply to yourself is that we typically only look for answers in our field. We're very, very inward looking. We do a lot of introspection, which is great, but it also means that a lot of really great ideas from elsewhere in industry and academia and science, they don't really sort of permeate at all. And the real risk here is that because we only end up looking in our, for answers in our field, the niche that we inhabit gets smaller and smaller and eventually becomes overly over a long enough period of time. We used to laugh at the box huggers, like particularly in like, you know, early 2000s of, oh, why would you do that? Like, you could just run everything in the cloud, right? But I posit that building your own platform as a service in AWS today is the 2019 version of being a box hugger. The sad fact is that commercial off-the-shelf platforms as a service like Heroku, Cloud Foundry, meet the user needs of about 95% of developers and development teams that are out there. So the real risk is that your niche is going to disappear. Deming said it best, it is not necessary to change. Survival is not mandatory. So if you want to stay alive in this industry, it's really important to move up the stack, understand the business model and the operating model of your organization, learn and acquire these skills to navigate uncertainty and ambiguity, kill your heroes. Where we are right now shall pass. Thank you.